too short here. Hello, everyone. I hope you enjoyed your lunch. We're going to go ahead and get started with our program now. I'm very excited to welcome you all to this special book launch luncheon of Reagan's Legacy in a World Transformed by Paul Kengor and Jeffrey Chidester. Jeffrey was going to join us, but unfortunately he had a flight delay, so he's going to join us digitally by Skype, so we'll see him in a few minutes. The first thing I'd like to do, though, is I'd like to welcome a couple special guests, Lou Euler and his wife, who are here with us. We're very excited to have them here. Lou, as our speaker today, Dr. Kengor says, is an expert on taxes. He was a member of President Reagan's cabinet, and he is our special guest at the ranch tomorrow, so we're very excited to have you both here. We're also very excited to have a number of our supporters here today. Without you, these programs would absolutely not be possible. As you notice, there are a number of students in the audience. We have a program this week called the Principles of Reagan Conservatism Seminar with Dr. Kengor. And basically, the students are learning a crash course on President Reagan. They're probably learning more in 2 days than they'd learn in a high school or college class, all 4 years of high school or college. So I can tell you, I've learned more about President Reagan in the last 2 days than I did all 4 years of my college experience. I've had a number of students tell me that they wish Dr. Kengor was a professor in their school because they certainly don't hear a lot of these conservative ideas at their campuses. Now, the topic of today's luncheon, Reagan's legacy, is definitely a topic that's a big deal in the media and the public today. You know, people ask questions a lot. Who is the next Ronald Reagan? How do we carry on President Reagan's principles? And, you know, I think that's up to people in this room. I think that our two speakers today will talk a little bit more about that, but I'm very excited to see a lot of the students here learning about Reagan's principles and maybe taking the mantle of Reaganism into the future and making some great changes in our country. So one thing I'd like to point out before we kind of start here is we have a book sale table right over there. So if you're interested in buying any of Dr. Kengor's books, we have a selection of his books over there. You're more than welcome to. And what we're also going to do is we're kind of going to retroactively do a prayer and a pledge here. So first off, I'd like to bring on Branton Nestor. Branton was a spring intern at the Reagan Ranch Center, a student at Westmont College, and the president of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter at his campus. Last semester, they brought David Horowitz to campus, so he's done a lot of very good things with YAF, and help me welcome Branton.
Let's pray. Dear Father, thank you for letting us live in this amazing country. Thank you for letting us be free and live in a state where we can enjoy this freedom and make the most of it. Thank you for Young America's Foundation and individuals like Dr. Tainer who are committed to continually teaching the next generation the values of freedom and faith in making that freedom meaningful. Father, we just thank you again for this opportunity to be continually shaped. And as we remember that freedom's never more than one generation away from extinction, we thank you for groups like Young America's Foundation that continue to spread freedom and the value of liberty to the next generation. In the name of Christ, amen.
Thank you, Branton. Now, next to lead us in the pledge, I'm going to bring up Ashley Estebo. Ashley is a student at Westmont College. She's the current chair of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter at her campus. She's been to a number of student conferences, including the National Conservative Student Conference a couple weeks ago in D.C., but she's never been to the ranch before, so we're excited to introduce it to her tomorrow. So help me welcome Ashley.
Please stand. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. You may be seated.
And next, I'd like to bring up to reintroduce our speaker to a lot of the students and introduce him to our supporters, Allison Wetzel. Allison is a summer intern here at the Reagan Ranch Center. She is a student at Grove City College and a member of their Young Americans for Freedom chapter there. She's been involved in many of our programs, so we're excited to have her here. So help me welcome Allison.
Hello. Dr. Paul Kengor is a professor of political science at Grove City College. He received his doctorate from the University of Pittsburgh Graduate School of Public and International Affairs and his master's degree from American University School of International Service. A New York Times best-selling author, Dr. Kengor is the author of numerous books, of which include The Crusader, Ronald Reagan and the Fall of Communism, Takedown from Communist to Progressive, How the Left Has Sabotaged Family and Marriage, 11 Principles of a Reagan Conservative, God and Hillary Clinton, The Judge William P. Clark, Ronald Reagan's Top Hand, and the two New York Times bestsellers, God and Ronald Reagan and God and George W. Bush. He is also the co-editor with Young America's Foundation alumni, Peter Schweitzer, of Assessing the Reagan Presidency. Dr. Kengor is often quoted in major publications from USA Today to the Los Angeles Times and the Washington Post to the Associated Press, not to mention many foreign publications. His articles have appeared in numerous publications from across the ideological spectrum, from the New York Times to the USA Today, and many more. A frequent contributor to MSNBC and Fox News Channel, Dr. Kengor is a regular columnist for Town Hall and the American Spectator and has appeared on many television shows, including The O'Reilly Factor, Tony Snow Live, Fox and Friends, and The 700 Club. He has done hundreds of radio talk shows, including the shows of Sean Hannity, Michael Reagan, Glenn Beck, Michael Medved, and Laura Ingraham. Hosts like Rush Limbaugh have discussed his work on air. Dr. Kengor is a frequent public speaker. His past venues have included the National Presbyterian Church, the Reagan Library, the National Press Club, the U.S. Capitol Building, the Commonwealth Pennsylvania Prayer Breakfast, and the Heritage Foundation, among many others. He has also spoken at many colleges and can be hosted on your own campus through the Young Americas Foundation. Dr. Kengor has done work for many think tanks, including the Heritage Foundation and the Allegheny Institute for Public Policy. In addition, he is the executive director of the Center for Vision and Values, a conservative think tank rooted in Christian scholarship located at Grove City College. Here, I have been asked to promote the Center for Vision and Values, so I would like you all to check it out. Our website is centerforvisionandvalues.org. We are also on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, and Tumblr at Vision Values GCC. These are only, however, half of Dr. Kengor's accomplishments. As a student at Grove City College, I have had the pleasure to take all but one of Dr. Kengor's classes and can say without a doubt that he is one of the most popular professors on campus. If you are so lucky to get into one of his full capacity courses in Middle Eastern politics or major European governments, you are left with an implausible amount of knowledge and inspiration to fight for conservative values. I can honestly say that he has inspired me in an uncountable amount of ways. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming Dr. Paul Kengor.
Thank you, Allison. That was too nice. Really appreciate it. And it's part of the Grove City Mafia that we have here today. Andrew Coffin is a Grove City grad, and he was in, I think, one of my first classes at Grove City College in 1997, fall of 1997. And when Jeff pops up on the screen, he was also a student at Grove City College. So we've come here to take over in Santa Barbara. That would definitely be an invasion of some sort, I can assure you. If Grove City College suddenly came to Santa Barbara, things would be run very, very differently. But the reason for those of you who are new right now, we've been doing a seminar for the last couple days on the 11 Principles of a Reagan Conservative, which is a book that I did that came out last year. And we have a new book that came out this year. It's called Reagan in a World Transformed. And Jeff and I were the co-editors. Jeff, can you see me? You can't see me. I can see you. Yeah. Okay. There's about 2,000 people here in the audience, and I'm wearing a tuxedo.
No, I can see you.
Yeah, okay, all right. So don't be too nervous as you address this huge throng of people here. But Jeff was going to fly out here, but encountered enormous problems getting from Charlottesville to Chicago to wherever else. So he's at the University of Virginia, correct? Somewhere on campus at the University of Virginia, Mr. Jefferson's University, as they call it. So the way that this book came about that we're talking about at this luncheon today was in 2011, the Reagan Library and Foundation put together a number of different centenary events for the 100th anniversary of Ronald Reagan's birth, for what would have been his 100th birthday. And among these, the University of Virginia Miller Center did an event at the National Press Club in Washington. And so Jeff organized that. And Jeff, that one was focused specifically on Ronald Reagan's impact in foreign policy on the world. How many people did we have at that? How many speakers were at that? At least a dozen.
We had five panels and then two keynotes. The one was Brian Mulroney, which packed the ballroom of the press club, which holds, you know, about 400. And then, but I'm sure we could have gotten more if we had more seats. And then we had a round table, which was hosted by Andrea Mitchell, that included Jim Webb, John Warner, the former senator from Virginia, John Negroponte, and I believe Richard Haass, looking at the Reagan global legacy, which was the point of the whole conference. So it was a great lineup.
Yeah, it was really well done and impressive to see people bipartisan, both sides of the aisle, Democrat, Republican, liberal, conservative. And when it was over, Jeff came to me and said, "Hey, we should turn this into an edited volume. We should publish some of these papers as a book." And I said, "I don't want to do that, because these academic presses, and they're never interested in volumes on the presidency. They're never interested in edited volumes. They always see these as conference papers from academic conferences, and there's never any interest in it." But Jeff talked me into it. And so we put together 10 to 12 people all together from the start. We start off with a group of about a dozen. And then we submitted this volume to a couple of different places. And we thought, well, you know, we didn't want to do this to begin with. Why not shoot for the moon? And we sent it to Harvard University Press. And shockingly, they said yes. So Harvard University Press to do a book on the Reagan presidency, edited by two guys from Grove City College. I guess they didn't know that. Harvard University, right? Harvard University Press has done some really good, really bipartisan work. In fact, they did the famous Black Book of Communism, which came out in 1999. And so we sent it to them, right, Jeff? And it went through a very long, rigorous 2 to 3 year review process, after which we jumped through a number of hoops, but made a number of improvements on really good suggestions by people. And amazingly, they published it. So Harvard University Press has published a book on the Reagan presidency, edited by us two clowns, right, Jeff? Sort of.
Exactly.
Exactly. So I'm going to give a little bit of an overview just for about 5 minutes and of some of the contributors, and then Jeff is going to tell you about what he wrote about in the book, his chapter, and then I'll tell you about the chapter I did. But the book focuses on the legacy of Ronald Reagan, his impact on the world from the period of 1981 to 2015. And so for that, we brought a bunch of different scholars, top Reagan scholars from all over the place, people like Beth Fisher, University of Toronto, Julian Zelitzer, who is at Princeton, Kim Holmes at the Heritage Foundation, Henry Now at GW, George Washington University. Henry Now did a chapter on Reagan and economics. We have a chapter on globalization. Kyron Skinner, the great Reagan scholar. Kyron Skinner is the one who, at the Reagan Library 10, 15 years ago, found the original original transcripts of Ronald Reagan's radio broadcast from the 1970s. They were literally sitting in the basement of the Reagan Library. And Kyron Skinner, who at that point had been an assistant to George Shultz, Harvard graduate herself, and she found this box. What is this? And each of them were 300 to 400 or 500 word Reagan radio broadcasts from the 1970s. We thought these were lost. And also, too, most people didn't realize that Reagan wrote them himself, but he did. Reagan wrote many speeches himself. This was something when he was president, right? Older people can remember. Liberals were always saying that Reagan was a dummy, never did anything on his own, but Reagan wrote most of his content. Certainly he wrote the radio addresses. So Kyron Skinner did a chapter on Reagan's legacy on terrorism, the war on terror. I did a chapter on Ronald Reagan's impact in the Middle East, his concept of a march of freedom. A lot of people don't realize this, but when George W. Bush was looking to spread democracy into the Middle East, with Iraq and Afghanistan in particular, he was citing Ronald Reagan's march of freedom and Reagan's June 1982 Westminster speech. That's where Reagan talked about spreading freedom and liberty into Eastern Europe. So Bush picked that up and said, that march of freedom into Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, we're now going to take it into the one world that has been the most resistant to democracy and freedom, and that's the Middle East. And that's quite a challenge, right? Do you think that'll work? I don't know. It doesn't look real good right now. But anyway, George W. Bush, that's just one of many examples we show in the book of Reagan's legacy after his presidency on this world transformed. Kyron Skinner, Elliot Cohen did a chapter on Reagan's defense policies, and we finished the book with chapters from Kim Holmes and Barry Carter on Ronald Reagan's impact on the UN, the Law of the Sea Treaty, and the INF Treaty, and a number of other different treaties. So that's sort of an overview. Jeff, you did a chapter. Tell us what you did. Jeff's chapter is the best chapter in the book. It really
well,
is.
Mine was on Reagan's continuing legacy across Eastern Europe. And so that's what I'm prepared to talk about today.
Go right ahead. It's all yours. All right.
Well, thanks, Paul. And it's great to share the stage with someone of such a long and extensive biography. I'm going to have to work on mine.
Right. Yeah, I wrote it myself.
Well, first, let me apologize for not physically being there. I try not to make it a habit of turning down free trips to Santa Barbara. But as it was alluded to, I ran into some airline issues that were probably enough to fill a whole other volume. And so I do apologize. And I want to thank Andrew Coffin for the invitation. And for all the work you're doing, Young Americas. I also want to thank Amy Brooker and Andy White and Brent Kilper for their help in connecting me in this imperfect but still useful way, I hope, making my participation possible. So I can only see – first of all, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, perfect, actually.
Great, okay. I can only see about 50 of the 2,000 in the crowd, but for those I can see – how many of you watched the first GOP primary debates last Thursday? Okay. So among the many, many interesting takeaways from that night, this one stood out. Rick Perry invoked Reagan on immigration policy. Rick Santorum pointed to Reagan's famous phrase about Washington not being the solution but being the problem and said that he was, quote, a child of Ronald Reagan. On finding consensus with Democrats, Lindsey Graham said, quote, I will be the Ronald Reagan if I can find the Tip O'Neill. Fast forward to the main event, John Kasich defended his expansion of Medicaid in Ohio by saying Reagan expanded Medicaid 3 or 4 times. On Iran, Rand Paul said, quote, I am a Reagan conservative, and said he'd negotiate from a position of strength much like Reagan did with the Soviet Union. Also on Iran, Mike Huckabee said that he holds to Reagan's famous adage, which he used all the time with Gorbachev, trust but verify. Ted Cruz noted how Iran released U.S. hostages on the first day of Reagan's presidency because they respected the power of the new commander-in-chief. And then everyone's favorite, Donald Trump, even invoked Reagan himself when he was discussing how he's evolved on certain policy issues over time. And none of this is surprising. I mean, Reagan, as you know, remains an enormously popular figure in American politics, and most Republicans, and indeed a lot of Democrats, try and share in some of the Reagan spotlight. But it gets to a much larger point. It's almost 35 years since Reagan took office, and Ronald Reagan remains a referential figure in politics. Now, by referential, what I mean is that people refer to Reagan to make a larger point. So when Rick Santorum says, I'm a child of Ronald Reagan, that refers to Reagan's philosophy about the size of government. And so for these people, Reagan is the embodiment of certain principles. And decades later, they're invoking Reagan to advance those very principles. That's truly the definition of legacy. So the focus, as Paul said, of our volume was on Reagan's global legacy, and it shouldn't come as any surprise that Reagan is also a referential figure in Eastern Europe. And that's the subject of my chapter, which is what I'm going to talk about. No region experienced a greater long-term transformation than Eastern Europe after the Cold War. And many within Eastern Europe credit Ronald Reagan to some degree for bringing about the end of communism. My chapter didn't seek to relitigate that. I didn't try and build any causal connection between Reagan's policies and what happened there. Instead, what I focused on was Reagan's continued relevance in the region's civil discourse, which in many ways is quite remarkable and unique for an American president. So for us to understand how Eastern Europe came to view Reagan, it's important to first set the context for when he took office. So I'm going to give just a quick overview of U.S. policy in the region from the end of World War II into the beginning of the Reagan administration. It's sometimes hard to remember that the U.S. and Soviet Union fought on the same side in World War II. Toward the end of the war, polls showed that there was actually little fear amongst the American public of the spread of communism. In February 1945 at Yalta, Roosevelt and Churchill get Stalin to support something called the Declaration of Liberated Europe, which committed all of Europe, all of it, to democratic self-governance. But FDR, urged on by folks like Churchill, soon became concerned about Soviet activity in the region, especially in the East. Truman entered office with a pretty healthy skepticism of Soviet activity, although there were still reasons to be optimistic. For instance, Hungary, Czechoslovakia had free elections. But Moscow continued to interfere in the internal matters, especially in the East, and the writing soon became very clear. Kennan writes his long telegram in February 46, saying the Soviet Union must be contained by the threat of force. 2 weeks later, Churchill delivers the famous Iron Curtain speech. In March of 47, fearing the fall of Greece and Turkey to communism, Truman announces his support for both, ushering in the policy of containment. Subsequent events continue to harden both sides, the extension of Marshall Plan aid, the creation of the Common Form, the February 1948 Czech coup, and then a month later what turned out to be a 13-month-long blockade in Berlin. All this activity culminates in the formation of NATO in April 1949. In the summer of 49, the Truman administration is actually still interested in rollback. NSC 58-2, which was signed in October of that year, sets out to bring, quote, the elimination of Soviet power from the satellite states. However, rollback essentially dies shortly after with the approval of the landmark NSC 68 document, which was signed at the high point of the Korean War. Now, notably, this document was pretty much silent on Eastern Europe. There's a brief hope for rollback during the Eisenhower administration, especially among folks like John Foster Dulles, the Secretary of State, and Richard Nixon. But NSC 162 made it pretty clear that the administration believed that liberation wouldn't happen except, quote, by Soviet acquiescence or by war. When Moscow went into East Germany in 53 and Hungary in 56 and crushed rebellions in both nations, the Eisenhower administration showed it was not prepared to go to war. And Eisenhower then said that he favored a, quote, evolutionary approach. John F. Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson essentially continue this approach. Kennedy had some limited engagement with Yugoslavia and Poland, but he was really careful not to be seen as, quote, soft on communism. LBJ was hopeful that this so-called bridge-building policy would lead to increased economic ties and hopefully some peaceful cooperation. But relations declined when the Warsaw Pact invaded Czechoslovakia in August of 1960. And then Johnson, as you know, became preoccupied with the war in Vietnam. Nixon continued down this track, though in October of 72, he asked for a full policy review of the region. And 7 months later, he issued NSDM 212, which called for expanded economic ties, but only for those who expanded what he called satisfactory political conduct. Nixon became friendly with Ceausescu of Romania, who was actually the first Eastern European head of state to visit the U.S. in 73, and also with Tito in Yugoslavia, and he liberalized trade restrictions with the region. Ford continued to work with what he called the favored trio of Romania, Yugoslavia, and also Poland. And by executive order, Ford made Romania the first Eastern European nation with most favored nation status in April of 75. He also sold anti-tank missiles to Yugoslavia and had a series of reciprocal visits with Polish leader Edvard Gierek. Eastern Europe soon became quite a liability for Ford, though. As some of you remember, first there was a signing of the Helsinki Accords, which made, quote, inviolable the post-war borders in Europe. Ford also said in one of his 76 debates with Carter that there was, quote, no Soviet domination in Eastern Europe. Not that smart to say. And he also turned down a visit with Soviet dissident Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Jimmy Carter, when he came in, he obviously saw the world differently, but policy was in the main the same. He still favored preferential treatment for Poland, Romania, and Hungary. But he said that the ultimate objective in the region was, quote, reconciliation, not liberation. It's a very telling quote by Stu Eisenstadt, who was Carter's domestic policy chief. And he said, there are certain events over which you have limited control, Poland being the perfect example. As we'll turn to next, Reagan fundamentally rejected this idea. So when Reagan entered office, it was fairly easy to predict that things would change. As far back as 1951, he was involved in something called the Crusade for Freedom, whose mission was to bring freedom to those behind the Iron Curtain. In his famous Time for Choosing speech in the 64 campaign, Reagan accused Lyndon Johnson of selling out the region, essentially saying, quote, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. He was apoplectic about the Helsinki Accords. During the 76 campaign, he charged Ford with putting America's stamp of approval on, quote, Russia's enslavement of the captive nations. And in speeches, radio appearances, private letters, things that Chiron Skinner and the Andersons dug up, the liberation of Eastern Europe is really a recurring theme for Reagan. So we know when he enters office, he has a different plan in mind on how to approach Soviet communism. Poland gave him that early opportunity to chart a different course. So in the summer of 1980, there's a series of worker strikes in Poland. In September 80, the Solidarity Trade Union is formed 10 days into his presidency. January 30th, at a National Security Council meeting, Defense Secretary Cap Weinberger recalls, it was there that we decided the need to make a stand on Poland. The importance of Poland was really clear. Reagan said it represented, quote, the first major break in the Red Dike. It was also important to the other side. Brezhnev said the very fate of socialism is at stake in Poland. It's very important. At a September 15th National Security meeting, a report delivered by Al Haig said that the failure to help Poland would be, quote, the modern equivalent of Yalta, a historic act of indifference. Options, however, were unfortunately limited, and they sent a short-term aid package to trade unions. December 13th, Poland turns it up a notch. They declare martial law and ban Solidarity. And at an NSC meeting a week later, Al Haig says, you know, we've done pretty good. Why don't we just consolidate our gains and use them as a starting point for future gains? And Reagan says very forcefully, this is the first time in 60 years that we've had this kind of opportunity. There may not be another in our lifetime. Can we afford not to go all out? This is a really clear break from his predecessors, as you heard from the Stu Eisenstadt quote. The administration imposed sanctions on Poland and on the Soviet Union. The sanctions, though, were not supported by America's Western allies. In June of 82, there's another series of sanctions on equipment and technology that the Soviets needed to build the Siberian gas pipeline. Again, this also angered the Western alliance, who stood to gain economically from the pipeline. But the administration held strong. This was not lost on the people across Eastern Europe. The fact that the administration stood firm, this was something that was not lost on them. A month earlier, the administration had released NSDD-32, which was really a big break from prior strategies in that it essentially restored the element of rollback. So one of the key objectives of the policy document was, quote, to contain and reverse the expansion of Soviet control. On that document, Reagan's then National Security Advisor Bill Clark said, Reagan made clear that the United States was not resigned to the status quo, Soviet domination of Eastern Europe. We attempted to forge a multi-pronged strategy to weaken Soviet influence and strengthen indigenous forces for freedom in the region. Poland offered a unique opportunity. Outside of Poland, though, options were somewhat limited, and his policy actually mirrored that of his predecessors. So NSDD 54, which was released in July of 82, said the plan was, quote, a continuation of differentiation toward Eastern Europe, which has been U.S. policy for nearly 20 years. It'll differ in that we will proceed more cautiously and with a clear sense of our limitations, including budgetary ones. Now, notwithstanding that, let me be clear, Reagan set out to defeat Soviet communism. If you need more proof of that, I hear there's a stack of books in the room that you can buy, and I commend them to you, which make that point very well. There's a famous quote that Reagan told, of Reagan speaking with his first national security advisor, Richard Allen. He says, my theory of the Cold War is this, we win and they lose. So Reagan always wanted to defeat communism, but he needed to exploit targets of opportunity when they arose. Most of Eastern Europe wasn't fertile ground. Now, Angola was, Afghanistan was, and Poland was. Now, a good deal of Polish aid was done covertly with the help of the AFL-CIO and the famed Holy Alliance with Pope John Paul II. They utilized Radio Free Europe to provide news and moral support, despite the fact that the government continued to try and jam signals. About two-thirds of Poles, on average, listened to Radio Free Europe. Solidarity leader and future president Lech Walesa later said of Radio Free Europe, its importance cannot even be described. Can you conceive the earth without the sun? They also engaged in economic warfare, convincing Western banks not to extend short-term loans to Poland, that they needed to make debt payments. Vladimir Kutinov, who was a central banker, later said that the U.S. forced our hand in Poland. Meantime, they continued to court the more independent Eastern European nations. Vice President Bush, in 1983, for example, visited Yugoslavia, Hungary, and Romania. The rhetoric also differed from prior administrations. Reagan, Bush, Schultz, Weinberger, they all repeatedly talked about Soviet repression. This was noticed, again, by the people in those nations. Now, I know we're short on time. We could spend hours literally on the details of Reagan's policy, but you get the general thrust. So what's Reagan's legacy in Eastern Europe today? Well, he has two kinds. The first, which is the most common of political legacies, is decidedly retrospective in nature, and it deals with Reagan's role in the Cold War. Now, Warsaw has two statues of Reagan, each over 10 feet tall. They have three Ronald Reagan squares. There's two big statues of Reagan in Budapest as well, including one in Freedom Square. Prague has a Ronald Reagan Square, and the list goes on and on. Most of the leaders in the region credit Reagan with being in the pantheon of leaders who helped end communism. Some say he was the reason. So that's the most common legacy, and that's easily understood. But the second legacy is more interesting and much more unique. Today, Reagan symbolizes a set of principles within Eastern European political dialogue. This is prospective in nature. Now, much like in the U.S., I mentioned the Republican debates, politicians in Eastern Europe still sometimes invoke Reagan because he's popular. So someone in the spirit of, hey, if Reagan did it, it must be right. But most references fall under one of two categories. One is Reagan as an advocate for freedom. Couple examples. When Chinese dissident Gao Zhisheng was suspected of being detained by the Chinese government, a senior minister in the Czech government, whose name I'll not try and pronounce, said that the West needed to find, quote, a new Ronald Reagan to challenge Beijing, much like Reagan had the Soviet Union. After elections in Belarus in December of 2010, President Lukashenko took some harsh measures against his opponents. Europe, as they are wont to do sometimes, were conflicted over the response, some favoring sanctions, others saying that that might be too bold of an approach. Mikolas Zurinda, who was the Slovakian foreign minister, recalled the impact during the Cold War that Reagan's very tough, very clear stance on communism had, and he argued for similar clarity with Belarus. When Polish libertarians fought against the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement in 2012, the party leader Janusz Palachot invoked Reagan, saying he was the symbol of the fight for freedom. The list goes on and on. The second image is of Reagan as the standard bearer for a set of free market economic principles. Again, just a couple examples. In the early months of the Obama presidency, there were several Eastern European prime ministers and heads of state that were concerned the U.S. was turning its back on Reagan-era principles. So Czech Prime Minister Mirek Topolánek said, "It's true what Reagan said. Governments do not resolve anything. They themselves are part of the problem." And President Václav Klaus said, "They need a return to the revolution of Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher." Germany's economic minister advocated tax cuts as a means of economic growth, pointing to the Reagan boom years. Albania's Prime Minister Sali Berisha said that Reagan provided him a great lesson with the importance of low taxes and said that's what helped Albania get through the Great Recession. Finally, when fighting over the EU Constitution, Czech Foreign Minister Karel Schwarzenberg said that there is so much bureaucratic complexity and red tape that it would have to be dramatically streamlined to get Czech support. His quote's great. He says, "We need a great European deregulation similar to what Ronald Reagan did. Reagan was someone who, by deregulation, paved the path to a new economic upswing. Europe needs Ronald Reagan." So what does this all mean? Is Reagan part of the daily or even weekly political dialogue in Eastern Europe? Certainly not. And for that matter, actually, I don't think any politician is. But it's been more than 25 years since the fall of the Berlin Wall, and Reagan maintained a very potent, powerful legacy across Eastern Europe. Much like Martin Luther King symbolizes justice or Gandhi symbolizes peace, Reagan symbolizes a set of free market principles and a belief in political freedom. He's become, in that regard, sort of a patron saint of the center-right in Europe. When Reagan took office, he set out to accomplish a small list of big goals: restore American power, reduce the size and scope of government, expand global democracy, confront Soviet communism. His symbolic legacy today in Eastern Europe is a reflection of the goals that he set and a large measure achieved during his presidency. Thanks. Yeah.
I think that's fascinating. I mean, you know, Reagan is always invoked here in the United States by Republicans, but he is even in Eastern Europe, of all places. And the fact that they would be building statues to Reagan in the Czech Republic and Poland, kind of like the huge Reagan statue in downtown Santa Barbara, right? That we drive by. But no, that would be here. That'd be about it. But no, I think that's I think it's fascinating. Truly, a referential figure and a reverential figure in a way too, right? I'll summarize my chapter in just a few minutes, and then we'll take questions because we got to be mindful of the clock. We need to finish up by 1:30 our time, Pacific time. But my chapter, I did two chapters, and the one is on George W. Bush's invoking of Reagan's March of Freedom and taking it into the Middle East, the which I mentioned prior. But the other one, the longer chapter, is on Ronald Reagan's legacy. I would say the two greatest foreign policy legacies. One is the complete transformation of Eastern Europe and the takedown of the Soviet Union, like Jeff talked about. The other is a world with a greatly diminished threat of nuclear war. And you know, people, older people in particular, are nodding right now. You younger people, you can't imagine a time when everybody was always worried about the big one, about the atomic bomb. In the 1950s, all the Twilight Zone episodes focused on bomb shelters and the movie in the 1980s, The Day After. When we were, you younger folks, you can't imagine this, but I was born in 1966. I remember in the 1970s going to elementary school, Center Township Elementary School in Butler, Pennsylvania, and doing duck and cover drills, right? And the young folks, you don't even know what that is. But I remember one drill in particular. There was this long hallway sloped down, and there was a brick wall, and we all lined up along that, and we put our head right down between the floor and the wall, and we covered like this. And when I got home from school that day and my mom asked what we did, I explained that we did bomb drills. because everybody was afraid that at some point there was going to be nuclear Armageddon between us and the Soviets. So Reagan is elected in 1980, and people are on the left in particular are saying he's going to blow up the world. This is this trigger-happy cowboy. He calls the Soviet Union all these terrible names. But what I show in the chapter is that for Reagan for decades, and well, going certainly throughout the 1970s and late 1960s, he believed in this concept of peace through strength, that the only way you were going to bring the Soviets to the negotiating table was if you were strong enough to draw them to the negotiating table. They weren't going to come in and cut their nuclear arsenal if we just, on our own, offered to cut ours. So Reagan believed you had to build up in order to build down. You would get peace through strength. So before you could get the Soviets to remove their 500-some intermediate nuclear forces in Eastern Europe, you had to build and deploy 500 intermediate nuclear forces in Western Europe on the United States side. And that was really hard to do. An entire movement called the Nuclear Freeze Movement popped up in response to that. But Reagan did that. He built them, deployed them. And then on December 8th, 1987, Ronald Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev came together at the summit in Washington, D.C., and they signed a treaty banning that entire class of nuclear weapons, all of those INFs in Eastern Europe and in Western Europe. And Reagan thought the only way you're going to get the Soviets to do that is if we put ours in, and then they'll pull theirs out. But that treaty, that is to this day the greatest of all nuclear weapons treaties. They signed a treaty that actually banished an entire class of nuclear weapons. These were nukes that had a range of about 300 to 3,000 miles, and the entire group of them completely banned. Another treaty that Reagan did and that was eventually finally signed in 1994 under Bill Clinton and Boris Yeltsin was the START Treaty. And this cut by 80% the START stood for Strategic Arms Reduction Talks, which became Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty. These were the super big, long ICBMs that went across continents. And Reagan and Gorbachev negotiated an 80% cut in those nuclear weapons. Jimmy Carter and Brezhnev during the detente era, they had what they called was SALT. You guys remember, right, some people? And SALT was Strategic Arms Limitation Talks. And what they were trying to do was cap the growth in the number of nuclear weapons, cap the increase. So if both sides had, say, 5,000 nukes in 1980, then by 1985, they weren't allowed to have more than 5,500. By 1990, they weren't allowed to have more than 6,000. So it capped the growth. Reagan said, this isn't good. They're still growing. So Reagan wanted to actually reduce the number of nuclear weapons, and he pulled it off. So ironic, Reagan was a nuclear abolitionist when, in fact, people on the other side were arguing that this was this nuclear arms, happy, crazy cowboy who was gonna blow up the world. So what I show in my chapter is that Reagan had that strategy, that peace through strength strategy, not once Gorbachev came in 1985. Reagan was talking this way in the late 60s and 1970s. And I give quote after quote showing this one after another. And the great thing is it's in a book published by Harvard University Press. Never, we didn't think that would happen, right, Jeff? So that's my chapter. Jeff talked about his. We'd be happy to take any questions that you have. We got about 10 minutes, Amy, right? Okay. Questions from the Spellbound group.
Would you talk about the impact of Reagan's legacy in the nuclear arms agreement that's being entered into with Iran right now, and whether we've seen he as an abolitionist be succeeded by our current president that seems to be renewing that threat?
Yeah, it's a great question. And when we get back upstairs at 1:30, I'm going to go through a section on peace through strength. And there's a Reagan quote. I wish I had it in front of me right now. But Reagan said, we learned long ago that when you negotiate with the Russians, you had to approach them with an olive branch in one hand and a sword in the other. And what Obama has done, especially with Putin and the Russians today, is he approached him with an olive branch in one hand and a bouquet of roses in the other, and Putin just bit it right in half. And one of the biggest mistakes, I think Jeff would probably back this, I know the exact date because I teach the history of the Soviet invasion of Poland. On September 17th, 2009, it was the 70th anniversary of the day that the Red Army invaded Poland under Stalin in compliance with the Hitler-Stalin Pact. And there's no way anybody in the Obama administration knew this, but they should have. And the Polish people know it, because I know the Polish people really well. Two of my books have been translated into Poland, so I hear from them all the time. But on September 17th, 2009, the 70th anniversary of the Soviet invasion of Poland, President Obama canceled the plans for a joint U.S.-Polish missile shield. And he also canceled the plans for a joint U.S.-Czech missile shield. And he did that for pro-Russian reasons to accommodate Vladimir Putin. And when Putin saw that, Putin didn't think to himself, oh, I've got a good pal here in Washington. As Reagan would have said, the Russians understand strength, not weakness. And Putin said to himself there, great, I can roll into the Ukraine if I want to. And I don't have to worry about who's in charge in the United States. And so you might think that's blaming too much on the current president. What I'm saying is what Reagan said, that the Russians appreciate strength, not weakness. And Putin is an old KGB guy. I mean, when our president wants kind of warm and fuzzy PR moments, he shows himself being photographed with little kids lighting the White House Christmas tree. When Putin wants a warm and fuzzy PR moment, he shows himself shooting a rhinoceros or, you know, out chopping down trees with no shirt on. And the Russian people, they love that kind of stuff. So it's a different, Bill Clark used to say it all the time. He used to say, that's so Russian, Paul. That's so Russian because of the Russian mentality. Jeff, any thoughts on that?
Well, I was going to mention the shirtless Putin stories, but you got me there. What's the saying? You know, keep digging until you hit steel. And I think that our adversaries continue to dig, and they just have yet, you know, over 6 years into the presidency, hit steel. And so I think it's hard to look at this deal in isolation, but it's part of a much larger strategy that the administration has tried to put into practice that's based on trying to find common ground with people that truly are not that interested in finding common ground. And so I think it's part of a much larger failure in the administration's foreign policy.
Well, and you see the worldview difference, right? And, you know, here, this is why, too, the background of the people that you elect matter. And when you look into the backgrounds of Ronald Reagan, his upbringing, his mentors, President Obama and his, and people accuse you of using that material to try to smear whoever you don't know, their backgrounds matter, because you come into office with a philosophy, a worldview, experience. Whereas Ronald Reagan had as his closest advisor Bill Clark, President Obama's is Valerie Jarrett. That's all you need to know. I mean, she was raised in Iran, by the way. She went there in 1955. Read my piece in American Spectator 3 weeks ago, Valerie Jarrett.
Where we are in the life of an administration. I mean, you know, you're at the point where you typically have the C and D team helping out. You know, when a president comes into office, he's surrounded by the people that he knows and trusts, and those people are long gone. I mean, most second terms run into this. I mean, President Reagan ran into this to some extent. But, you know, you look around, there's a reason why the folks that are running foreign policy weren't the first choices in the first term. And I think you're seeing the fruits of that.
You know, look too, Jeff, at the confluence of world leaders. You alluded to this in your talk. When Reagan comes in, Margaret Thatcher had just been elected. John Paul II had just come in. I mean, John Paul II, he's the first non-Italian pope in 455 years. The first Slavic pope ever, and he's from Poland, of all things, Poland. And then Gorbachev came in 85, Lech Walesa was there. So all these people came together. Michael Reagan argues that it was providential. This was just so perfect. With Obama, I don't know who the kind of common allies, the kindred souls are. Right, who's he? His counterpart is Putin, and Mahmoud Ahmadinejad prior to the current Iranian leader.
Yeah, I'll leave it at that. I'll get myself in trouble if I say anything more.
Okay. You're not as safe at UVA as I am at Grove City. Let me make the stupid comments. Yes.
Is this on? Okay. My question is, out of all the candidates that are running for president right now, which one specifically do you think have the most Reagan-esque foreign policy?
Wow. Jeff, do you want to take a stab at that?
Yeah, Marco Rubio.
I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah. I think Rubio has a sense of what America is that is so positive and so infectious. I mean, there's so many conservatives that, you know, want to really run on why they're not Obama. And that's not good enough. You need to have a positive vision for what conservatism means and how it's going to be able to govern the country and set a course for the future. And I think he's done a very good job of that. I also think that he has an interesting worldview from a foreign policy perspective. His time working in foreign relations in the Senate, I think, has really helped. And so I think he sees the world much in the same way as Reagan does. But he has a very, shining city on a hill mentality about America. And I think, to me, he reflects Reagan the most.
Yeah, Marco Rubio's background and the way he tells it, being the son of Cuban immigrants, reminds me of Reagan's statements in the Time for Choosing speech and the farewell address. And Rubio recently gave a speech, I think at the Council on Foreign Relations, mm-hmm. where he quoted Reagan a number of times. I agree with that. Other than Marco Rubio, Jeff, anybody else?
Maybe Kasich. I think there's some strands that I think are similar with Kasich. I think Kasich also, absolutely is willing to try and find areas of progress. Working with anyone that'll work with them. And I think that's something that's sort of lost in these days. You know, I think that Reagan was very willing to compromise, and that's a good thing. And I think that Kasich has some of that. And I think, he likes to refer to Reagan a lot. I think being the governor gives him some of those opportunities. But I see something in his demeanor and his outlook, his policy outlook, that somewhat mirrors Reagan. But the rest of the group, not a ton, I don't see, really.
But
honest.
You know, the two others that evoke Reagan a lot are Scott Walker and Ted Cruz, and I see elements there as well. He's not saying anything. do we need to stop, or do we have time for one more? Anybody else? No, they're so mesmerized. They don't to see two people at academic institutions who are conservatives. They don't know what to. Go ahead, Jeff.
I said I think they fell asleep from me talking too long.
Yeah, no, not all. That was very good, very good. All right, well, great, Jeff. Thanks so much.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much to both of our speakers. Just a reminder, if you want to purchase one of Dr. Kengor's books, they're right over there. We have Danielle right over there, so she'll be able to help you out. I would really encourage you guys to get 11 Principles or the book on Reagan's legacy that they just talked about. You got just a taste of it, so it'd be great to read the entire book. So for students in the audience, I'd like to send you guys upstairs. So if you want to follow Allison, who's right back there. We are going to go back up to the classroom for our next session on Peace Through Strength. So we will see you guys all soon. Thank you very much.